ערב טוב לכולם, מפאת האורח, תרשו לי לעבור לשפה האנגלית. Good evening, everybody. I'm Gabriel Motzkin. I'm the director of the Van Leer Jerusalem Institute, and it's a particular joy and honor for me to host this lecture tonight. I host lots of lectures. Tonight I'm doing it in cooperation with the Minerva Center, run by Rivka Feldhai at Tel Aviv University, and with the Cohen Institute at Tel Aviv University. We together, all of us in the Polanski Academy, have together put together this package trip by which Michael Hagner is with us. Now, Michael Hagner has an interesting career in the sense that he's both a medical doctor as well as a philosopher. And that's what's informed his career, that he actually is on both sides of the great divide. And he spent much of his life working actually on the consequences of brain science and wrote several books about this, some of which I even had the pleasure of reading. And so I think he's really one of the leading creative intellectuals of our time. He's at the Eidgenössische Technische Hochschule, it's called the ETH, Swiss Federal Institute of Technology, where he chairs the Department of Philosophy and History of Science. Now, he's lately gotten interested in something entirely different, which is the question of the production of the book, the writing of the book, the reading of the book, what this all means, the digital age. And we had the pleasure of hearing him with the Polanski postdoctoral fellows this afternoon in the first part, where he talked more about the production. And I think you want to talk more about the reception now. So without further ado, because I don't think you came to hear me, I'm going to ask Michael to come up and give his talk, please.
Thank you very much, Gabriel, for this very kind and flattering introduction and for bringing me here. I'm proud to say that this is not for the first time that I give a lecture in Jerusalem. And so it is really a touching honor to come back and back again. Yet the topic about which I want to talk now, that is really new. As I say, as Gabriel said, it is to a certain extent, it is very different from my studies in the history of the neurosciences, particularly the history of cognitive neurosciences in the 19th and 20th century. Yet, in another sense, to which I will come back in a minute, it is not that far away. Okay. In 1996, 10 years after his death, Susan Sontag wrote a letter to Jorge Luis Borges. I quote her. "Some people think of reading only as a kind of escape, an escape from the real everyday world to an imaginary world. Books are much more. They are a way of being fully human." And she continues her letter, "When books have become texts that we interact with according to criteria of utility, the written word will have become simply another aspect of our advertising-driven televisual reality. This is the glorious future being created and promised to us as something more democratic," unquote. So this statement by Susan Sontag is melancholic and pathetic. It is an exaggeration, and it is quite right. 20 years after, and 12 years after Susan Sontag's death, Sontag, we have been, in these 20 years, we have been confronted with many concepts to make digital spaces of knowledge palatable to us, such as, I mean, some of them are already, can already be found in Susan Sontag's letter, such as interaction, participation, utility, openness, democratization, universalization, integration, networking, and some others. And in the midst of all those discussions on the generation and circulation and reception of knowledge, in midst of all that is reading. Reading as being the most, arguably being the most contested human technique. So in the next 45 minutes, I would like to delve into this topic. And it's not that I would dare to give an answer to Susan Sontag's question to what will happen, but maybe a kind of diagnosis of the situation can help a bit to come to a clearer picture. Since I used to work as a neurophysiologist many years ago, and since I am a historian of science, what I will do is present both in my talk. So it will consist of three chapters, three parts. The first part is the shortest one, and that is a very, very brief sketch of the neurophysiology of reading. Very brief, without any, you know, visual stimuli, so just the word, nothing more. Then there's as a historian, I'm of course allowed to talk about the history of reading, though that will be pointillistic, given that there are many very important books on the history of reading. And the third part then will be a reflection on reading in the digital age, including some consequences it might have. So let me come to my first part and give you a very brief sketch of neurobiology. Reading and writing is not older than 6,000 years. That has consequences for our biological understanding of reading in the sense that it is not a result of evolution. There has been no pressure on natural selection so that particular parts of the brain are reserved for reading as it is the case with other properties that make us human. They are indeed part of evolution. The capability of reading is not. The fact that there are specific areas and the possibility for developing certain neuronal circuits that are activated when reading just say that evolution made our brains flexible and plastic enough so that these regions and these circuits can be developed. Arguably, they have been used for the reading of traces for many ten thousands of years before, and this, of course, was relevant for the survival of human beings because they had to know when to hunt and when to run away. But that has nothing to do with reading. So neurophysiologically speaking, reading is a quite complicated and energy-consuming process in the brain. And when we read an easy text, or when we flip from one text to another, we don't realize that. As soon as we read a more complicated text, this complication in the brain is the equivalent subjective feeling for that is that we get tired and that we get exhausted. And this is exactly due to this neurophysiological complexity. That has consequences in the sense that the process of reading cannot be substituted by any other human capacity. So not by visual culture, not by oral culture, and not by mathematics. All these capabilities include other circuits and other areas in the brain. So it is irreducible. The other thing is that although the brain is plastic, that is only to a certain degree. That is, if you do not learn reading before the age of, say, 10 or 15 or maybe 20, you will never learn it as fluent as you would if you learn it as a child. The same with playing the piano or any other instrument. If you start with 25, you will never end up as Horowitz. I mean, most people won't end up as Horowitz, of course, but, you know. So if you start as a child, then you have a very good chance to be a decent a piano player. So reading has to be learned in early age, and it has to be trained. If you learn reading and then don't continue reading, then again you will end up in problems. And it is not like bike driving that you can activate it at any time. It is rather that simply the circuits that are involved in a way degenerate. So reading means exercising permanently for your entire life. So we should not forget those very simple neurophysiological facts, which have to do with the architecture and the biology of our brain. I come back to that. So end of part one. Now I come to part two, a very pointillistic history of reading. It is ironic that Western philosophy, in a way, starts with a no-go. And that is the Socratic understanding of reading as we know it from Plato's dialogue Phaedrus. It is, I think, Phaedrus 275, in which Socrates argues against reading. He is not a friend of reading and writing because, so his argument goes, knowledge is created in conversation among men, those days men, who are curious and who like talk and back talk. What is crucial for this argument is that silent reading was completely unknown. So the practice of reading those scrolls was simply reading out loudly a few sentences, and Socrates thought that this is acceptable for memorizing or for stimulating conversation. But by the end, it was no more than knowledge that you know anyway. And then he continues, it is better to talk directly, to have a direct oral access to the soul of your partner, and that takes place during conversation. So reading is a kind of detour. I think that two points are important in this early view of reading and writing. The first is that delving into a text and gain something new from this text was not a concept in Socratic Athena. It was not a concept. And the second is that Socrates argues that the externalization of memory is a danger because it might impair our knowledge. And this argument comes back in the digital age. Okay, so I mentioned that inspiring readings was unknown. That occurred in a completely different historical context, namely in Augustine. In book 8 of his Confessions and in several other chapters of the Confessions, Augustine writes about his fascination when he was in a garden in Milan and saw Bishop Ambrose enwrapped in silent reading. In another passage, Augustine writes about a man who occasionally found a scroll, a book, about the life of Saint Anthony, and he read it, and the reading transformed this reader. It transformed him. So what is going on here? It is not the idea of an autonomous reader, but it is the idea that silent reading in solitude facilitates a new relation between the reader and the book, a relation that never existed in the Socratic world. Reading is no longer subject to immediate conversation or explanation or condemnation or censorship. It is rather that you are alone with certain thoughts and in a silent conversation with the book. So what comes into play here is the factor of time. Namely, the time you spend with the book without being interrupted. Now, I do not want to argue, following, of course, people who have worked about this. I'm not a specialist for that. I do not want to argue that this was the birth of silent reading. In fact, the historical establishment of silent reading was a very long process that started in late antiquity and went up to the 15th century. So that is a time period of almost 1,000 years. According to Paul Sanger, who has written a very stimulating monograph on this topic, the most crucial aspect in the history of silent reading is the separation of words, that there is space between the words. If you read Roman texts, original texts, which are engraved in a stone, there is no separation of the words. If you read it out loudly, it's no problem, because you are slow enough that you can differentiate between the words as long as you are capable of reading Latin, of course. For silent reading, this is not very helpful. There are other factors involved, and that is the shift from the scroll on Pergament to the Codex, which again started in late antiquity. And then, of course, and now I make a huge jump to the 15th century, of course, Gutenberg's invention of bookprint. To be sure, he was not the first one. It was first developed in China much earlier, but we have no knowledge at all that any of these Chinese technologies made its way to minds in the 15th century. What it is As I would evaluate what historians have said about the printing revolution, as Elizabeth Eisenstein called it, what I would say, it is not so clear whether the printed letters and words immediately changed the character of reading. This is very hard to say. But what is for sure is that that the printers in Venice and in, you know, all those European cities where printing workshops opened up after 1460, that very quickly they did no longer know who were the consumers, who were the readers of the books they had printed. That is very much in contrast to the multiplication of manuscripts before. So, in fact, there were more readers. The forms of reading we know today, and now I again jump from the 15th century to the 18th century to the Age of Enlightenment, the forms of reading we know today are summarized is beautiful because it's Samuel Johnson who summarized that in 1755. And Johnson distinguished between the hard study, reading with a pen in your hand, that is the first mode. The second is the perusal, that is the searching for information in a book. Third is sequential reading when you are engrossed in a novel. And the fourth mode of reading is what he calls mere reading. So it's browsing through a text. So this distinction between different forms of reading went hand in hand with the so-called reading revolution in the second half of the 18th century. So the reading revolution is a term coined by book historian Rolf Engelsing in the 1970s, I think, and he argues that there is a major shift from extensive reading, and that is the reading of made shift from intensive reading, and intensive reading means reading one book or very few books many times, and that is of course the Bible, a shift to an extensive reading, and that is reading many things once or twice. And this extensive shift to extensive reading goes hand in hand, according to Engelsing, with the bourgeois as the reader. So here we have the birth of bourgeois reading. And that is reading for pleasure, reading for information, and reading for, you know, having a certain standing in the world. And it has another, and maybe the most important consequence, and that is that reading is the crucial element of late Enlightenment education. The Kantian philosopher Johann Adam Berg writes an entire book about the art of reading in 1799, and he argues that reading, the art of reading, is not there to accommodate knowledge, but to apply knowledge in a reasonable and self-determined way, which is really a Kantian argument. So I would argue that this is the time of the autonomous reader. The late 18th century is the emergence of the autonomous reader, and that means personal and political emancipation, to which reading is an important facility. And this is exactly what Marquis de Condorcet says equivalently in his words in his treatise on the progress of the mind from 1793. So from that moment on, from late 18th century on, reading is under careful and suspicious observation by scholars and intellectuals. It becomes subject to critical comments on the respective zeitgeist, and this happens in particular when new media are involved. And let me give you three examples for this critical evaluation of reading, and you will see with the third example, I will come quite close to the present. The first example is that when in the 1870s and 80s, daily newspapers started to become a mass phenomenon, Nietzsche worried that readers en masse no longer know how to read. So the more people are reading, the less the art of reading is developed. So in a way, it is an anti-Enlightenment, anti-Kantian argument. For Nietzsche, the consequence of general reading is that if there are bad readers, then the consequence is that you have bad writers and bad books. And this situation he describes, or let's say he stigmatizes as being the mind begins to stink. The mind begins to stink. So that is the first, that is my first example. The second example is from the 1920s. When the film became the dominant medium after World War I, the claim of optimization of reading, so no longer perfection in this enlightened sense, now it is more of an optimization, coincided with the idea of an acceleration of reading. And in consequence, the ideal was a scanning or skimming a text, as Jan Tschichold, the famous typographer, wrote in the late 1920s. So just hurrying over a text was the ideal for this historical situation in which the film became predominant. The third and last example for such critical interventions is the most important one, and that is Marshall McLuhan's prognosis of the end of the Gutenberg galaxy. When McLuhan wrote that in 1962, computers were still unbelievably huge monsters, mostly in halls of the military in the United States, and in some non-military institutions. But it was far, far from being on the desk of each and everybody, let alone in your pocket as a smart book. So, no, what McLuhan had in mind was television, was TV. It was the pictorial culture which he emphasized against the scriptural culture, and in a very, let's say, generalizing way, he summarized the consequences, the social as well as the psychological consequences of the printing revolution. And that is the end of medieval corporatism and the emergence of individuality. And that means that as a silent reader who is dealing with a defined or undefined number of books, you are being distanced to your subject and distanced to others, so you read in solitude, and this leads to a kind of what McLuhan describes as the power to act without to react. And this he saw as a precondition for Western superiority. So he had an extremely high estimation of the historical importance of reading, but believed that this was coming to an end with global networks, with the global village, which makes this kind of individuality and solitude impossible, and hence books superfluous. The idea is that that any human is directly connected to all humans, and this led him to the idea that libraries are irrelevant, that printed books are irrelevant, that all forms of gaining knowledge and of exchanging knowledge is happening on this on a social level of immediate interaction and conversation. So it is a kind of going back behind Augustine's claim for undisturbed reading. I doubt to link that to the Athena of Socrates, because I think the agora in Athena is a bit different to the global village. So hesitation of 3 decades, and with discussing McLuhan, but not really taking him serious, the situation changed in the 1990s with the advent of the cyberspace. That is a term that was coined by William Gibson, the science fiction writer, in his novel Neuromancer in, I think, 1986. And in the 1990s, the cyberspace was a kind of cultural phantasma, of cultural imagination. And this went hand in hand with a reclaim and with the prediction that print is dead, the printed book is dead, because it is too slow for the speed of circulation of knowledge in the cyberspace, because it is commercially uninteresting, and other reasons. And in this period, in the 1990s, the idea of new forms of producing and perceiving texts came up, and all that can be summarized under the term of hypertext and hyperreading, and I will come back to that in a few minutes. So now I come to my third part of my talk, and so we are now, we have arrived in the early 21st century. So what we witness today is a cultural clash, which confronts paper, print culture versus digital culture, the printed book versus the ebook. that discussion is happening on two levels. The first is that you can read your Dostoevsky in a printed book or on a tablet. Who cares? So the text does not change. The second thing, however, is new forms of reading and writing. And again, I come back to that in a minute. So the discussion was pushed by American journalist Nicholas Carr a couple of years ago in his book The Shallows, in which he diagnosed a digital dementia. And he argues that the internet makes us foolish simply because we can find each and every information very quickly, and this hinders us to think about what we read, and this overflow or this flood of information simply fills the channels and does no longer give us the chance to reflect. Here, I think we do have a revival of the Socratic argument in the sense that the externalization of memory weakens our own memory. Because if we do not train this, then this means that it will, you know, degenerate sooner or later, and then the externalized memory does not help us any longer. What is my problem with Nicholas Carr? My problem is first that we simply do not have sufficient empirical data to make that claim sustainable. We have personal experiences, everyday experiences, but in such an important question, I think we have to have more information, to have more empirical data on this. Second, it is not so clear whether Carr is really talking about reading with a digital device or whether he's talking about the cultural and political juste milieu in the US. You can say many bad things about this juste milieu, and this is probably justified. But I think these are two different things, talking about reading and talking about the political situation. And the third thing is that, according to Carr, sequential autonomous reading, as it was developed in late Enlightenment, so bourgeois reading, is for him the teleological aim of any kind of reading. And this is a kind of ahistorical argument, because reading in the biologic constraints has been open to historical development, and we simply do not know in which direction it will go in the future, at least not if you make sequential reading, as Carr is promoting it, make so unique and emphasize it so much. So, what are the results of empirical studies on reading? I mean, experimental psychologists work on this, and it must be a very frustrating thing to do that, because a study that was undertaken in, let's say, 10 years ago, comparing, say, two groups of students from university, one group reads a printed book, the other group reads on a tablet, and then you make a test on memory and on the understanding of the text, etc. So such a study would be completely unvaluable today, and you cannot use it any longer because these tablets and these screens no longer exist. So with each new generation of tablets and of digital screens, you have to start from the beginning testing these devices against printed texts. And this is a pretty frustrating thing. So we cannot say that much. But what we can say is that the results of these studies are uneven. Some studies show that there is a better understanding and a deeper understanding of a text on paper in relation to a tablet. Other studies see no difference between the media. Next, what can be said is that untrained young male readers, so young men, boys in their adolescence, they definitely prefer e-books because they have more experience with electronic devices anyway, with computer games, etc. So there is a gender bias in this. Third, the vast majority of students prefer reading longer texts and complicated texts on paper. They print them. They do not necessarily buy books, unfortunately, but they print out the text they find in the internet, or they make photocopies. So this finding seems to be really international. So there was a study that compared students in the United States, in Japan, and in Germany, and it was more or less the same in all those countries. So students prefer to print texts. Next point is the more difficult and ambitious the text is, the more there is a preference for paper, the lighter and the easier the text is, the less relevant is the media in which you read it. What is clear for sure is that digital reading has not made us to more precise, to more concentrated readers. We are, in this respect, we are not better readers. There is no progress in reading from this point of view. And this is, so to speak, where Nicholas Carr could come and say, look, I'm right. And this is a big but, the digital reading has made us too more flexible. We are more flexible readers. What does that mean, more flexible readers? One thing is hyper-reading. I call it hyper-reading because everybody calls it hyper-reading. You know what this is. This is a text which is enriched with links, and these links lead you to other texts, but not necessarily to other texts. It leads you to photographs, it leads you to handwritings, it leads you to films, it leads you to audio documents, maybe it leads you to tables, to statistics, etc. So the question is this reading? Is hyper-reading reading? I think the answer is not so simple, because in a way it is a multi-sensory reception of knowledge, because it involves visual, it may involve mathematical, it may involve audio information, and all that is not reading. And here I really would remind you of the neurophysiology of reading. It involves certain specified circuits, neuronal circuits, Whereas when you look at a statistics, look at a curve, listen to an audio document, then other areas are involved. All that then is brought together, and we think it is one and the same thing, subjectively, but neurophysiologically it is not. And if we would end up with hyper-reading, then we would lose one important aspect of reading. So, and what you lose is the sequential and coherence experience of reading, that is what we know since August time, that you spend time with one text and with nothing else. Just spending time. And that means a reduced understanding of the narrative structure and the argument of a complex text. But you also win something. You also gain something. And that is, first of all, associative branching, which can be very productive. And it is the discovery of references, scriptural or visual or audio, that were no more than an illusion in the text before the internet. And again, you gain something in this situation. So hyperreading has had its heyday in the 1990s, because the proponents of the cyberspace, about which I was talking a minute ago, saw themselves in the tradition of the counterculture, both of the West Coast of the 1960s and of French post-structural philosophy. So one of the strong arguments for the for the palatability of hyperreading was an association with Deleuze's and Guattari's notion of rhizomatic reading, which they developed as a kind of wild reading against the sequential reading, in which they regard the book as a tree, and this stands for order, for convergence, for homogeneity, whereas the rhizome stands for proliferation and for heterogeneity and for complex networks. So, and the argument went that hyperreading is the digital realization of rhizomatic reading. That was the 1990s. I think this idea is completely disenchanted, because the hopes on political emancipation are completely gone. Yet the idea of a multimedia navigation through visual, scriptural, and auditory spaces is, I think, the most relevant and the most important addition to the intellectual technologies that we have. But it does not substitute reading. So, which forms of reading can we distinguish today? I argued that that Samuel Johnson in 1755 knew four forms of reading which still sound familiar to us today. Today, I think I would say that that we can distinguish between six forms, and here I follow in part. The Chicago sociologist Andrew Abbott, who has written a beautiful book about digital reading published in 2014. So the first form, and this is again very close to Samuel Johnson, is narrative reading, and that is if you read a novel or if you read a non-fictional book, just you learn something and a kind of, I mean, I hate the word, but it's a kind of infotainment. The second form is analytical reading, and that is more complicated. That is what is certainly relevant for the humanities and what was developed in philosophy, which this is the kind of reading which brings the students to print their texts. The third form is skimming and scanning, and though this is a very old form of reading, we all know that in a digital text, this is much easier to do. You can even search for one word and find it immediately. The fourth form is what Abbott calls mastering a text, and that is flipping back and forth, reading in each chapter, and just mastering the argument of the book without reading it sequentially from the first line to the last line, first word to the last word. The fifth form is what might be called wild reading, which comes close to Deleuze and Guattari, and the development, the proliferation of that is then the hyper-reading. So when we summarize these, when we take these five or six forms of reading that are relevant today, then the question is, what would we prefer, print or digital media? And my answer would be both. Both. So we need both. When we master a text, when we read analytically, when we try to read Kant or Foucault, then it is hard to imagine that this will work with a Kindle. And the same is certainly true for when we read Joyce or Foster Wallace. The same with mastering a text. The full sensory motor circle that it involves to read, to use your hands, as Nietzsche says, to read with your fingers and your eyes. So reading is also a kind of motor activity, and to use a pen and to use all the fingers that are working within the leaves, within the pages of the book, all that, it seems that for this, the printed book is the perfect tool. When it comes to narrative reading, I think it's a question of preference. There are some people who prefer printed books, there are others who prefer their Kindle, and I think both is perfectly okay, with one important exception, of course, and that is that if you read on a Kindle, you are subject to a digital reader who reads you, in the sense that your reading behavior is transferred to Amazon or to any other company that sells you the tablet or the e-reader, and this is part of the game in data capitalism, that you simply give all the data you have when you read. If you think of the consequences of this, then you understand very well why Jeff Bezos was among the first who said print is dead. Because a reader who reads a printed book is a lost customer for Amazon. As long as you are not online, you do not deliver data. So too bad. So what they want is what Jonathan Crary, art historian and art critic Jonathan Crary, has described in his most recent book, and that is 24/7. That is that you deliver data to companies 24 hours a day, including reading. So that is my main argument against tablet. Not that you read on a tablet. For ergonomic reasons, that's pretty okay. So wild reading, again, involves both. I mean, hyperreading is clearly only possible with a computer. That's clear. But there are also other forms of wild reading in which paper is pretty okay, and that does not necessarily involve that you read in one book, so that you read in six books at the same time and flip from one to the other. And this kind of wild reading is often enough most stimulating. So in consequence, what I want to say, and this is my conclusion, and I come to the end of my talk, what we need to develop in the future is a new ecology of reading. And this new ecology means that we have to learn which media to use for which kind of reading. And in the past, we were not forced to reflect about that because there was just one medium, and that was the printed book. Whereas now, we have at least two kind of media, and that pushes us to reflect about the different forms of reading and flipping from one to the other and making our own experiences with reading. So, in consequence, what would one answer to Susan Sontag? The answer might be, you are right, the situation is dangerous, there is a threat, but the book is not dead, it is quite robust. Thank you very much.
Okay. All right, we're going to open a discussion, and I'm again going to do this terrible crime because I have irrepressibly a couple of things I want to say about what was said so far in this fascinating talk. First of all, why print out a book? I'll tell you why. It's a very simple thing that when I read a philosophical text, I write things in the margin. And I find it very hard to write things on a tablet in the margin. And so therefore, I'm consequently, and because I'm almost more interested narcissistically in what I have to say than what the book I'm reading has to say, maybe. Now, the second thing is that, I felt in your talk that there was a certain amount of cultural confinement. And I'm sorry to accuse you of that, but I feel I have to, because when we were in Cambridge, we lived next to a Japanese family. And this Japanese family, the kids were busy studying all day not to miss out on what's going on in Japan, so they had to learn thousands of characters. And they spend their first 5 years in school only learning how to read, something that we do, 26 characters, you learn right away. That's what they do. But of course, once they learn them, they go much faster because the characters, reading in characters is much, much faster than reading in any system that we could probably design because they're full units of syllabic units or everything else, and they move much more quickly. Now, our reading, you said 6,000 years. Well, that's not really true. Our reading is only 2,500 or 3,000 years old. The reason is that the system before that was a pictographic system, and that in the Sinai, they discovered a system for the visualization of sound. And what we have a system that visualizes sound, that brings together so that when you read, you actually almost speak the words if you're slow enough, and you can visualize the sound. Now, I was thinking, are we going to return to pictographs? Because you see that with the emojis and with things like that, whether you think that you can return to a pictographic system, and what that would mean. Would we have a way back? After all, our system was developed as a system for slaves to write in a symbolic system that the Egyptian masters did not understand. That's why they wrote in this funny system. But, that leads me to final consideration, which is, is there a better symbolic system than letters? Like, we're confined to letters, but I see my other son read equations. And I think how much faster this goes, you know, only except we use equations only for a small subset of the things we read for. But we have to think about what is the limitation. What I'm saying is our own symbolic system is much more important, I think, than the question of the technique or whether we read on a tablet or a book, which is we have an upper limit to how fast we can read because we're reading in letters, which by definition are easy to learn and very inefficient in terms of the consumption of information. Anybody who reads Hebrew knows that they've done studies. It takes longer to learn to read Hebrew than to read English, but once you learn it, everything goes much faster because it's a shorthand system, you know, at no vowels. So the same thing exists all the way around, which is the trade-off between learning the system and the efficiency of that system once you've learned it, which is not the same thing. So I'll stop there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. So, first of all, I mean, 3,000 years or 6,000 years, yes, it's true, it was Eikens, but what was special about it, as far as I understand, you know, the relevant literature, is that there was one Eikens after the other. Yeah? So it was not one Eikens, it was not two Eikens. It was not like in the cave of, you know, Lasso, in other caves, where you have a few, you know, iconic symbols. No, it was just one after another. And that is, you have a kind of what is called in German Schriftbild. So scriptural image. And this is a difference, it's a difference to an icon. It's also a difference to the icon that you see in everyday life, for example, in traffic, the icons in traffic, or all the traffics that, the icons that Otto Neurath entered in the 1920s. Yes, it's somewhere in between, but what happened 5,000, 6,000 years ago, is the sequence of icons that change it. And then, of course, and I did not go into detail, and I'm not competent to go into detail, with the letters, with Greek, and with the vocals, and with Hebrew, things are and other languages, things change again. I know that. So I have I really have simplified. But I would say there is more of a continuation of than of a radical break. So that is one thing. The other thing is, you know, I mean, when you come to Japan, and when you study the brain of Japanese, it is well known that in their brains there are completely different mechanisms for using their languages, and they have two languages, as you know. One is the letters that they write and read, and the spoken language is completely different from that, completely different. And that's the reason why it takes the poor kids to learn that for so many years and nothing else. So in other parts of the world, this is much, much easier for the kids, much easier. But you know, this is due to cultural variety, and culture shapes the brain. Culture shapes the brain. That is important, and that certainly leads to cultural differences. Then again, in Japanese culture to other cultures, which is fine. But we also know if a Japanese child grows up in Israel or in Italy and learns Italian or Ivrit, it immediately gets that. So again, that's a question of the plasticity of the brain and nothing else. So what to do with that? I mean, I have simplified the story, of course. But I would not say that this changes the argument profoundly. I have mentioned Japan once with this recent study on the behavior of Japanese students, and Japanese students use electronic devices even more than American students, and much more than German students. But still, when they read complicated texts, they print out the text. So, okay, that's all I can say about that, and maybe I should learn more about that. You're perfectly right. Yeah. I think I stop here.
Over here. Yeah. And then, yeah.
Okay, thank you for your presentation. A common thought, and you're welcome to address it.
You have a microphone, right?
Okay, thank you. So culture shapes the brain, for sure. I would assume, correct me if I'm wrong, that the different techniques also shape the brain and thus shape the human being. So you focus your talk a lot about reading, when on the table we have different techniques that we might or might not use, the tablet, the book. However, I think there is another dimension that goes on in the other direction. I'm thinking here about the work from Catherine Hales, Bernard Stiegler, Alain Giffard, and others, where there is a clear attempt to think through the impact of these new techniques on not only the brain in a plastical way, but on the captation of attention, of the inner conversation. You refer to the rise of individual reading as a phenomena of the autonomous being also, which has even impact for democratic education, for instance. So there is a whole dimension here about not only the reading as an activity, but the reader and the kind of human reader that these techniques over time might or might not shape. But I'm just mentioning the attention captation just as an example here, because I think we are learning more and more about the impact of all the captation of attention, not only in the digital or the regular book, but in the culture of screens in general. And this is all connected, obviously. So I'm just addressing this whole new dimension and love to hear your thoughts about that.
Okay, so, I mean, I have not mentioned Catherine Hales and Bernard Stiegler for the simple reason that I do not agree with them. So in the case of Catherine Hales, I think there is really a confusion about reading, because she argues that reading is not limited to human beings. She calls that speciesism, and thinks computer can read as well as human beings. And this is so far away, this kind of post-humanism is so far away from what I find interesting, that either I should criticize her very sharply or just ignore her. In the case of Bernard Stiegler, whom I like very much, both as a philosopher and as a person, it's more complicated because he is biased. He's biased in a way that, on the one hand, he's fascinated by these new technologies and these new ways developing new facilities that are hidden in our brain, which we do not yet know. And at the same time, he sees that digital capitalism is bloodily misusing that. And if you look at his texts on attention and of reading and of hyper-reading, he is flipping between these two options. And I do not really see to which of the two he wants to he wants to go further. So I find that a bit confusing. But I have to say, I'm in conversation with him. So I haven't mentioned him here. Because I do... it would be hard for me to prepare, you know, his argument, his clear-cut argument. Attention, I mean, yes. So you could tell the entire story that I have been telling almost by replacing reading through attention. Mm-hmm. And you have the same history of attention. It starts a bit later. It's an enlightenment device. It's a virtue for the bourgeois individual, and it gets a new notion in the 1920s, exactly when Chichold is claiming for skimming and scanning. Benjamin and Krakauer and others are writing about distraction and about the distribution of attention, and this is an enormous issue in our time in the early 21st century, and my argument would be the same. We have to develop an ecology of attention, which helps us simply. Which makes us capable of grasping the situation in which we are. So it is one of the crucial crucial virtues of dealing with our environment in a proper way, like reading.
Thank you, Professor Lister.
Thank you.
Microphone.
Two quick questions. The one at the beginning, you said that one gets tired from complicated texts. Isn't it so that one can get tired from simple texts and get stimulated from complicated texts, which would explain why some people take simple books to fall asleep? The other question, relates to the politics that I tried to follow in your account. And there are different versions of politics. You came out strongest against the illusion of the politics that were there with the hypertext, with Deleuze, with that moment. There are other moments, Benjamin's 1920 coming up with attention. It was a political moment as well. Which you didn't go into really. You finally got into the politics of today when you related this to the digital. So there you have you implicitly were calling for a resistance against the manipulation of the
digital capitalism,
of the capitalist abuse of collecting our data. These are very different versions of politics. My question there would go to, is that the only politics that you can see being at play today? Because that would mean that we should, for political reasons, stick with books. Is there another kind of politics? And wouldn't that be, in a way, a regressive one? Is there a way to go beyond rather than back?
I understand that. Well, first of all, I mean, your first question. I think that's very simple to answer for me, though it's perfectly justified, and that is: do not confuse boredom with relaxation. No? I mean, reading easy books before you go to sleep simply helps you to fall asleep, and isn't that great that there are books that help you to fall asleep? Wonderful, wonderful. If you are bored by a text, sometimes you have to read it because you think it belongs to your profession and you are a good scholar, so you have to make your way through the text. And unfortunately, most texts are boring in a way, certainly after a while. but still there can be an important argument. So the excitement about text I did not talk about that, but my topic today was the intellectual comprehension. I did not talk about excitement, about fantasy, about imagination, so about this entire Borgesian world of books. But it would be a misunderstanding if you think that I sharply separate these two. No, they belong together. They really belong together. The second thing is, I mean, you asked me whether there are other political strategies. Very well possible. For example, which ones? My only worry would be to say that book print is the past, because then you follow the ideology of Bezos et al. I mean, how can you say that book print is the past if you go to the Frankfurt Book Fair and simply see that in Germany, just in Germany, you have almost 100,000 new printed books per year. Almost 100,000. So it is decreasing a little bit, went down to 90,000, then it's 92,000 again. So book print is not that. I think that is would be really, if someone says that, then she has interests. And I'm very suspicious against these interests, you know?
I agree with you.
Well, I think that much as we would like to continue the discussion, I think we have to liberate our lecturer. And we want to thank you for a wonderfully stimulating evening. I hope to see you soon again.